Hello and welcome to the Irish Missionary Stories. My name is Maurice O'Keefe, and over the last year I've been recording, cataloguing and archiving 150 Irish priests, nuns and lay missionaries, all of whom served in the world's poorest and turbulent countries. Most of these people are now retired, and I am most grateful to them for their contribution to this project. Here are some examples from those recordings. And we begin with first appointments overseas after ordination and profession.
And the way things were done in those days, you got a letter in the mail, and I opened the letter in the mail. I opened the letter and said something to the effect, at a council meeting held in such and such a place on such a day, you were appointed on loan to Australia for 8 years. Please stay where you are for the present.
One day I had a phone call from our Superior General, and she just simply said to me, have you any trip to Dublin in the near future? And I said, no, but I can come up on the train any day, there's no problem. And she said she'd like to see me. And when, after greeting me, she said, I need somebody for Zambia. And she said, I feel you're the person. How do you feel about that? And I said, sure, certainly, if you need me for Zambia, I'm ready.
And we were called into this room. We were deemed it just for 21st December. And Nicholas Brennan, the rector, walked in and he stood there and there's a sheet of paper sitting up there. And he says, I suppose you want to know where yours are going. And we had our own favourites. Korea was the glamour mission. Building your own church, like, you know, showing them how to build bricks and make and all this, you see. The number two was the Philippines. You rode ponies through the jungle. But boy, you didn't want to go to Japan. All you could hear about Japan was you had to squat on this terrible language and you were nobody. And you worked your head off, and no results.
So I got into Yokohama, and we got in, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, we got up for the early breakfast, but we couldn't get off the boat till 9. You know, we're sitting there, and I saw these fellas running around speaking this strange language. Anywhere I could see, there was these strange signs, Japanese, Chinese characters, whatever you like to call them. And I said, Doyle, you must be crazy to be here. Absolutely nuts, you know.
Actually, it was a bit like, of course, I suppose, like exploration in a way that, it'll tell you now, say, we had these football leagues, the football teams, and the names of the teams were, the Punjabis was one team, so that would be a Pakistani area, Pakistan, the Punjab. The Dayaks was another team, that was an area in Borneo where we were working. So connections were all the time being made, you see,
yeah,
even subconsciously, I think, with what was going on out there. And we were mad for road, really, at the time, to get out, you know.
And after getting their appointment, it was now time to set sail for that long journey overseas.
We had sisters in Cape Town, so the boat went to Cape Town, so we stepped off in Cape Town. But it wasn't just going on the mission, it was leaving Ireland forever and family. So that was really I would always say the most definitive part of my life, the day I turned my back on Ireland, never to come back, never to see my parents, although my father said he'd come and see me, and he would have, but my mother couldn't make it, so he didn't like to come without her.
We were 3 weeks on the ship, yes. It was a cargo passenger ship. Most of the bigger part of it was cargo, but there was accommodation for 12 passengers. Just in rather cramped conditions, you know. It's the Elder Dempster line. We left from Liverpool at Port Harcourt.
Then I had entered in England. Then the following year, we were asked to write home for permission to come to India. And we were the first ship carrying civilians since the war had broken out.
Right.
The ship was the Stirling Castle.
To learn the language and the culture of the people was the first challenge that they had to overcome.
I would say the negative for me, and this is after I went to Japan, that I realized this, I'd been in Japan for a few years. What I realized was, I left Ireland at the time when I began to know my own culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that was a negative. You know, I went to Japan, like I came back, I had 1 year for ordination here, I came back for ordination 1 year, then went on to Japan the following year, in 1955. And after going to Japan, we were in a new culture again.
Yeah.
And someone mentioned along the way to me in Japan, someone in some context, like, it's very hard to get a new culture if you don't know your own.
The language there was a big problem, and we didn't learn it. Particularly in schools, we weren't given the opportunity. We were given 3 weeks to master the language. All we learned was to recognize the sins in confession so that you could hear confession, which was a joke, really, at that time.
You must know the culture of the people. You can know the culture of the people only in one way. There is no second way. No amount of books or universities can teach you. You must learn it from your own personal life, and you must live. Go and live with the people and live the same kind of life, imitate what they do. You gradually got into their way of living and their way of talking.
And there were times of great danger, and to find the courage and the strength to keep going was sometimes hard.
I remember one time they asked me to drive out the soldiers and their guns and bombs. They were being transferred to another place, and they told me to drive them out and to pick up. Now, these were all Tutsis, and this is Hutu country. And I felt that my driving the army around in Hutu country wasn't such a good idea.
Yeah.
So I do remember I told them there was no way I would do it. That was it.
Yeah.
I wasn't going to drive them, because that's what I wasn't there for that. And they took that very badly. And the day they were leaving, they got to pick up someplace else. I remember just before that, they used to pass down in front of the house and I just kind of spit out, and that. But just as they were leaving, they turned the machine guns and started firing over the house like that, you know. What they didn't know is that I wasn't in the house. I was over in the hospital at the time, but I could see what was going on. The tension there was unbelievable. You could almost catch it, you know, the tension in the place. And the soldiers were as tense as anybody else.
But my fear was, should I run away because my life's in danger? But then I thought, where can I run to? You know, I can run into the bush, but I'd probably get lost and maybe die in the bush anyway. So I felt, if I have faith at all, I better. And then it dawned on me, you're a missionary. You know, you came to Papua New Guinea not just as a tourist. This wasn't a tourist junket. This was a missionary. You're a Christian leader. And while these people mightn't have been the most active of Christians, they're looking to you now for help. And this is your time to help them. And somehow the grace of God and the guidance and everything, somebody must have been praying for me somewhere. I was led in a trance what to do and stick with it.
Two Columban fathers who served in China during communist persecution showed great courage.
I was finishing my bravery in the church when a Chinese priest had come at the time. He was director of Central School in Huzhou City, and of course, until he was ousted by the communists, so I asked him to come and take over my parish. I had a tip-off. I was going to jail. So, actually, he appeared in the sanctuary. I saw a revolver behind him. That's all I could see, who was following. So I said, the orders were to drop what I had, raise my hands and come quietly. I went very quietly out to the hall where the Christians met. So they appointed me to go against the wall, and I went over to take my place beside them. And he to the far wall. And they were speaking Northern stuff, and I couldn't understand it very well. I thought he told me face the wall, and Yes, he yelled, turn round. When I did, there was a firing party there on the other side ready. I thought that was the end of it. I used to see the mass executions in my window, you see. They were going on. They'd been going on for some time at that time, you know.
I remember well, there was the two of us that were together in those circumstances. We were under kind of house arrest in this particular church compound. And the man that was with me was a Father Eugene Spencer. He was an American Columban, a late vocation, and a great character he was too, God rest him. But I remember saying to him, 'tis a pity, isn't it, that we'll never be able to tell people about this? I remember saying that to him that night, because it looked so terrible, you know, it was real hatred. And he said something that I always remembered. Well, I guess, he said, how could you expect anybody, what difference would it make, he says, how could you expect anybody to believe us?
Coming face to face with the worst type of inhumanities was all part of missionary work, but it came at a price.
I was told to go and visit the prison. I said, what will I do in the prison? And they said, oh, just go. So I went, and the prisoners were in cells, single-story buildings, barbed wire in front of them, and their poor hands coming out through the barbed wire, covered with ringworm and scabies and every kind of disease you could think of. And I thought, oh my God, what do I do here? What do I do here? I'll tell you about one man. He was chained to the floor in the one position for 12 years. First of all, his 2 feet were out straight and his 2 ankles riveted to the floor, so he couldn't even stand up. But then one day he got mad and he just, with his 2 bare hands, he tore down the iron door of his cell. For that, they beat him unmercifully. They broke one of his legs and chained his broken leg to the floor. In the end, I got very sick and I was sent home. And I wanted to go back. I didn't want to stay at home.
The drive and determination to achieve great things was motivated by a desperate need for help, often working alone.
I was bringing the message of God for people that had never heard it before in this certain places. Now, later on, a long time afterwards, in the 90s, I was in a place called Sankwil. I was in that village, which is right on the Cameroon border. Now, I went to climb up a mountain called Kundave number 2. Kundave was a village away. You just had to walk.
Yeah.
It's way inside. And you drove up to Kundave 1 and you left the car there. And then you walked from there. Now, the hills were like the teeth of a saw, up and down, up and down. And this isn't the trap, meaning you're poor and sweat. And you get up there in a small little kip of a place, you know, a few houses. I'd say hardly 40 people in it.
I went out to work in Ogoni. I think you've heard of Ogoni, Sarah Weaver's place, you know. And I went to a house in Uyo, where they had a school and a house, the only house we had in Nigeria at the time, was a school there, a secondary school, and they were teaching there, and I was attached to that school until I went down to Port Harcourt. And I went down to Port Harcourt in an ambulance, this was provided for me by Father Crowley, if you ever met him, he's out in Kenya now. And I took up residence on my own in a small house in the heart of Ogoni, a place called Bomu, vacated by a Holy Ghost priest who has been deported from the country. And I began work there and mobile clinics. For very soon, gathered some staff around me, some volunteers and some qualified staff. And it was really a wonderful missionary experience.
They released 300 child soldiers to us under the auspices. You see, UNICEF are not an implementing agency. The fund, but they work with other agencies in terms of the implementation of programs, but they had nobody to run a program on child soldiers, so they asked the Catholic Mission.
We divided
them into 3 homes, 2 in Freetown and 1 in Bow. So we had 100 plus kids in the place in Bow. We got what used to be a social welfare building to house them, but we didn't know what to do with the kids. You know, what do you do with them? And they're wild, they're crazy, you know. And violent, you know, it was a bit scary. And, well, they were difficult to teach because their attention span was like 15 minutes. You know, they were highly traumatized kids.
And looking after refugees was undertaken by dedicated missionaries who really cared for those people and were remembered by those people.
I did get a decoration from the president, but that was, it was the people. I never accepted that kind of for myself. I accepted that with the people that worked with me. We had 93,000 refugees in the parish, and feeding them and looking after them and caring for them. And poor creatures had to come across that big swamp, yeah. The Kwanda River swamp. They were being shelled and bombed from the air by the South Africans and these gunship helicopters and MiG jets. So they didn't know what was going on. They weren't involved in any of that. They'd come over to us and all they had was the clothes on their back. Now, they had to come across swamps that were crocodile infested.
Yeah.
How many of them were lost? There'd be people there for days waiting to see if another member of the family made it. So that was horrendous.
What did you do to save them?
The army, the Zambian army, were able to give us lorries and helicopters to bring out food.
Yeah.
We had that food. We were able to buy food from Zimbabwe in those places and take it out by lorry. Tractors, for example, a funny thing happened when one of the drivers, he had one of these tractors, you see, and the roads were so sandy. You just put the wheels into the track and it would go off. But anyway, he had it on manuals. He had it on manual. And the next thing was a MiG jet came over him, flew over him. And of course he jumped off it.
Yeah.
And about he had to run 2 or 3 miles to catch the tractor. The tractor kept going.
And there came a time when it was necessary to hand over the mission to the native people.
Our role basically over the years is set up the church and, like St. Paul, move on. He went to the Corinthians, he moved on, he went to the Galatians and he moved on. When I went out first as a young priest in 66, I was in the Diocese of Ilorin. We were 100% expatriate priests. Today, there's no white priest left. We have handed over to the local church. So that's basically our mission. It's to do ourselves out of a job, really.
But I have come to the point now, after 10 years in Umburanas,
yes.
I've been working very intensively for 10 years. In this past year, we have been talking with the local people that somewhere along the way, you know, the missionaries come, we sow a seed, and that only really comes to flourishing when the people themselves take it on. So a point comes where we have to move away and let the people assume the things themselves.
I think maybe we're only in one parish now in Korea. And our objective there was to set up the local church. When I went to Korea first, there was one Korean bishop. And the other bishops were foreigners. There was a Frenchman, 2 Colombians and an American.
Yeah.
You know? Now, there's no foreign bishop.
Yeah.
They're all Koreans.
There were many missionaries who found it difficult to readjust after coming home.
It took me, oh gosh, it took me a long time to settle in again. And I said to myself, I made a mistake several times. So I went to Dalgan then for 6 months. Yeah, it was 2-3 months terms. And there were all missionaries there, and a lot of them were in the same situation they had come home to. So we got on and we made friends, and even 6 of us on that course, we go back every 2 years to make a retreat in Dalgan.
It was a very difficult time to come back, I must honestly confess, from having spent 20 years out in South America where I loved it, and coming back into a church that was very different. Whole change in church, whole change in how church is viewed, how religious life is viewed, how the brothers are viewed.
It took me a long, long time. It's taken me these 4 years to get over it. It was a very traumatic change. It was a way of life that I'd lived for 33 years. The people I'd lived with, Since I was in formation, I had nobody in the house to speak English with, so I was just with a lot of girls all the time, young girls. And you just grow into their way of life. You come back here and you see all the plenty and the waste and the materialism. It's just not the same. And we had started basic faith communities, you know, the theology of liberation there. So that was another, to come back to the church here, was a very different scene.
But I must say, the last place where I was, I would have loved to have stayed on in it, but I had reached the age of 81, and the superior general here, Seamus O'Neill, was out, and he came around to me, and he more or less said, Teddy, he said, I think it's time you had to hang up your boots, and I was sorry, but I had to leave.
And finally, the legacy left by Irish missionaries.
To my mind, it was liberation. I have several examples of it. Another one was in the island of Grenada, where in 1948, the Presentation Brothers started the first Catholic secondary school for boys. Again, the standards at the beginning were low, but gradually it improved. Then the students began to do better. In 1990, the government that was in Grenada was a native government, and the Prime Minister was a past pupil of Presentation College in Grenada.
Well, we've come to the end, and I hope you enjoyed listening to some samples taken from over 150 hours of recordings with Irish missionaries. And again, I would like to thank all of those involved in this project, and especially the Irish Missionary Union and Father Eamon Aylward, who helped me to coordinate this project. My name is Maurice O'Keefe, and for more information you can visit irishlifeandlore.com.